Mentioned that Japan is kind of slow or tight in a way, but that kind of slow culture is leading to a strength in Japan's economy.
A lot of Japanese startups that I see now that I think are really, really good are actually in the deep tech category. All that means is it takes longer. You can't be an aerospace startup and be a unicorn in 2 years. That is not going to happen.
That's right.
And so I think the Sushi Tech Tokyo idea is great for that because the more we can bring ideas together and the more people come.
皆さんこんにちは、ピボットの竹下です。注目のゲストをお呼びしてビジネスやビジョンを聞くビデオポッドキャストシリーズ&トークを始めます。今回はですね、寿司テック東京2024が変える東京をテーマに、寿司テック東京2024グローバルスタートアッププログラム実行委員会の提供でお送りします。今回はですね、前回は、東京都副知事の宮坂さんに出演いただいたんですけど、2本目もかなり注目のゲストです。以前ピボットに出ていただいて、今今日時点で130万再生ぐらいされていて、カリフォルニア大学サンディエゴ教授のウリケ・シェーデさんがゲストです。ウリケ・シェーデさんは、日本の経済をめぐるナラティブを完全に変えちゃった人です。日本経済と停滞する30年とか遅いとか全然イノベーションできないっていうのではなくて、実はその遅さに日本企業の強さがあるんだということを前回語っていただきましたが、今日は引き続いてそういった遅さの強みが1年間立ってどう変わってるのか、そしてそれがスタートアップのカルチャーにどう影響しているのかということを聞いてみたいと思います。では早速、日本企業研究の、ウリケ・シェーデさんを呼びしたいと思います。よろしくお願いします。So, Professor Urike Shade, welcome back to Pivot.
It's wonderful to be here. Thank you, Ryan, for having me again.
So it's been almost a year since we last talked, and believe it or not, our last interview reached 1.3 million views.
Thank you very much. That's all because you're such a great
interview. It was because of you. I think it was because our narratives was different from other narratives. It was not a negative narrative about the last decades, but rather a positive one. And you mentioned that Japan is kind of slow or tight in a way, but that kind of slow culture is leading to a strength in Japan's economy. So today we want to talk about and deep dive that on topic.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Thank you.
So let's talk about how Japan can change using that strength of becoming very tight, very slow. But I think we'll talk about this, but there's a lot of companies that are not seen, but are doing well in the global market. And also even this iPad is made of Japanese products. So let's talk about that. And also we want to talk about startups because remember we first met at the event held at City Tech Tokyo. It was a year ago.
Yeah, that was last year.
Last year. Wonderful.
Yes.
And today the Tokyo Metropolitan Government is hosting another event. It's called Sushi Tech Tokyo 2024. It's concentrated on startups. Expected to be the Asia Saidaiq, one of the biggest, largest startup events in Asia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's wonderful. So first of all, last year was really a great event. Mm-hmm. And I was impressed by the depth and breadth and the interactions of the exhibitors and how it was all arranged. And I believe this year, so this is like the second one, it'll be even bigger. Right? So I think this May event will be great, great opportunity, not only for Japan to showcase its startups or for foreign startups to come to Japan and showcase their technologies, but also for the startups to meet and for the businesses and venture capitalists to see and appreciate the growth of Japan's innovation ecosystem.
Do you think that's happening? Because since we met, it's been a year. Do you think, what are you witnessing right now?
Oh, it's totally palpable. I come and go, right? So unlike you who are here every day and you might be like the frog in the water, not realizing it's getting cold in this case, right? So change is happening. It really is. I feel it. A colleague told me about how corporate governance is really changing. What large companies are doing is really changing. And my students in Kazumika Seki are telling me it's really changing. My former students that are not in Kazumika Seki are all changing jobs. It's changing, right? So it's happening. And so I think the Sushi Tech Tokyo is happening at a very good time. And I would expect it to be even bigger and more interactive than it was last year.
So we want to touch upon the Western narrative, especially Western media. I think you mentioned in your recent book, there are four patterns of Western media narrative. One is Japan is old. Two is we cannot innovate. Japan is not good at innovation. Number three, too many robots. Number four, Japan is a weird country full of Neko Cafe. It's a good culture, but maybe it's weird in a Western context. Neko Cafe, Meido Cafe. Why are there so much negative narratives
so
on Japan?
I think the, yeah, I mean, it's a little bit upsetting, isn't it? I mean, it's just like, that's just, does not describe Japan, as far as I know it. Mm-hmm. So, and this actually came out of a conversation I had with a friend in the United States, who's a really well, you know, read, well-informed consultant. Mm-hmm. And that's what he knew about Japan. And I said, why do you say that? He said, that's what the newspapers write about Japan. That's all I hear.
Okay.
Right? And so then why is that? Mm-hmm. And I think that people abroad have lost interest in Japan other than maybe the cultural production, whether that's maid cafes or food or anime and manga. And I mean, this idea that Japan is filled with old people, I mean, this is like by the numbers is wrong. Mm-hmm. Right? This will happen and it's a challenge. Mm-hmm. But right now, I think we already talked about this, right? Only 29% of Japanese are older than 65 years old. Mm-hmm. That means that, right, 71% of Japanese are younger than 65.
So 70% younger, okay. That's a good point.
It's not. Mm. I mean, so it's all relative. Mm-hmm. But I think the larger story that happened there with a narrative is that, you know, a narrative is just a fancy name for story.
Yes.
And a story can be framed. Mm-hmm. Right? So how you tell the story, you will get some emphasis on it. And the story of Japan for the last 30 years, in my view, has been told by American economists or Japanese economists who have been trained in the United States.
Yes.
And they tell a story that goes like this. After World War II, Japan was not very good. Then they caught up. Then the bubble happened. The bubble burst. And then Japan had three decades of stagnation. And stagnation means no GDP growth. Mm-hmm. And therefore, that means Japanese economy is bad, and Japan cannot innovate, and there are all these zombie farms, and so and this is an economic story told from the perspective of an American who is trained in economics like they work in the United States. In the United States, GDP growth is super important.
Right.
Presidents win or lose elections. Right? The unemployment rate is because the labor market is so fluid. Companies go, you know, go bankrupt, they fire people. So the unemployment rate is also an indicator that rises or drops the president's ratings. That is not true for Japan. That's just not true. In this country, you know, GDP is important, of course. I mean, everybody wants to grow. I mean, it sounds good, right? But that's actually not the only thing that's important. So the narrative or the story that we could tell about Japan could be like this. So what do you think? Here's my story.
Okay.
After World War II,
yes,
it took Japan 30 years to catch up with the West. Japan was very excellent at learning and adopting production processes and technologies. This resulted in fast economic growth. Then came the bubble. The bubble was actually really sort of a demarcation point where Japan had arrived. And then it took Japan, has taken Japan, you know, a little bit to get over the bubble, but then 20 to 30 years to change the economy, to pivot the economy, to transform to no longer being the follower, but the technology leader.
Ha, interesting.
And it took 30 years to catch up with the West. Now it's taken 20 to 30 years to turn from a hunter to the hunted, where countries like Korea and China, and of course also Taiwan and so forth, are trying to catch up with Japan.
Okay.
So Japan is now competing at the technology frontier. And it took 20 to 30 years to make that happen. By the way, that's actually a normal process. It took Germany that long. It took when the Japanese products first arrived in the United States, it took the United States 10 to 20 years to turn into a technology leader. So completely normal process.
So you're saying that Japan's kind of moving to a different path instead of just following the United States and the Western
world. That's correct. We're done following.
Okay, so let's talk about the new path. In which way is Japan so innovative and so such a global leader in that sense?
Well, we don't know, right? That's what the future is going to bring. That's why we have, you know, startups and sushi tech Tokyo. We don't know what the future will bring, but currently what I see is what I call the Japan inside strength.
Japan inside.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, you remember the old, or is it still actually, the Windows personal computer?
Yes.
There was a little sticker on it that said Intel inside.
Intel inside,
right?
Yes.
So that we knew what was powering this.
Mm-hmm.
There's no sticker on your thing there.
No.
It doesn't say Japan inside.
Yeah, it says designed by Apple in California.
And probably made in, you know, whatever.
Yeah. Yes.
It doesn't say Japan inside. However, some 30 to 40% of the value added of that thing is made in Japan.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So it's Japan inside, right? And we see this everywhere. I mean, there are certain production processes of a semiconductor where Japanese companies have a 100% global market share.
Mm-hmm.
So if that wasn't there, we would not have semiconductors. So every single item you use that has a semiconductor in it actually has a little bit of Japan inside.
Right.
Now that's a little bit me, right? But people don't know. So it's Japan inside. And then that's maybe quiet, but that doesn't mean it's not powerful.
I see. So it's quiet, but powerful
innovative.
Okay.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I have a graph to show you how Japan is good at making complex materials. And I was surprised to see this chart that whenever we see such kind of chart, we see Japan declining, lost decades, but Japan's keeping the top. Could you walk us through this graph?
Yeah, isn't this amazing?
It's amazing.
When I saw this first, I didn't know, I thought they made a mistake or something. So this is from Harvard University Growth Lab. And they have a program called Atlas. And what they do here is they look at the productive knowledge of countries. And that's very complicated, and so I could give a whole lecture for an hour. But the, but the short of it is that they look at products and how complex they are, the difficult to make, right? So how complex is a product, and how many other countries can make it, and so or you know how common. So if you think of a T-shirt, that's very easy to make in a lot of countries make it, right? But if you think of carbon fiber for airplanes, it's very complex. And the Japanese companies dominate that market, right? And so what they do here is they look at export products. So they look at every country's export products and look how complex is it and how many other countries export the same thing, right? And what we see here is that straight through this transformation period that some people say was a lost decade.
Lost 30 years, but
lost 30 years.
We don't see
Japan
any.
Japan has the most complex, you know, most difficult to make export bag, right? And what's interesting also about this chart is that the United States is losing it.
Right.
That's worrisome.
Yeah.
That really is worrisome. I mean, the U.S. of course still is a leader in biotech and semiconductors. Mm-hmm. It can't be beat. But this is exports, right? And so maybe some of the U.S. strengths are not fully reflected in this because the U.S. is such a big market for, you know, itself. But still, and then of course we see the rise of China, Thailand. And Vietnam, that's also remarkable. So Vietnam is basically going from T-shirts to something, something
more
else
complex
entirely.
Things. You think we need a different metric? Because we always like look at like S&P 500 or those kind of, you know, data. But we need these kind of data to.
It's very complicated, right? Because how do you assess this?
Yes.
And here's another point
that
actually is important in this. All of this is about exports, right? So I have looked at the productive activities of Japanese companies abroad. And this started actually during these last decades, right? So after the Japan rose to be a world leader in consumer products, places like the United States and Europe required that Japanese companies built a plant there. There's a so-called local content rule. And so Toyota and Honda and Sony and Panasonic all started plants in the United States. So the Japanese car companies are now the largest employer in automobiles in the United States. And they sell more cars than the American cars, right? So it's a great success story for America. It will not show even in the export data. Right, so as long as we look at exports, The data are just really only telling half of the story. And GDP too, because GDP that only measures what's produced within Japan. So all of the things that Japanese companies abroad are producing are not even included in those data.
Ah, interesting.
And I looked at those data and it's very difficult, it's complicated. I get some help from my students and, in the various ministries and METI and so forth. But basically the sales of Japanese companies abroad have been increasing at a very fast rate over the last 25 years. And that's actually, that's my, maybe my next project.
I don't know.
It's very complicated, but yeah.
Let's talk about 7 P's of Japan.
Oh.
Yes. So what is 7 P's? What, profit, plan, portfolio? Yes, PR.
Yeah, so so this actually is what how I started this whole research that I'm presenting now and writing books about, right? So this is way back in 2010. It was like the second lost decade. And everybody was so negative, right? Well, you know, and it was bad.
Yes,
it was bad. So there, but still there were some very good companies and they're very profitable. So some of them we know, right? So we know that Phanuc and Keyence have long been profitable.
Yes.
Right? They have operating margins of 45% or something. So it's fantastic. And so I thought, okay, so who else is profitable? So I made a list of companies and I ranked them by operating margin. And there were some very profitable companies at a time when Japan was really struggling. So my data was from 2000 to 2010. So that was a really bad time, right? So in that bad time, who were those great companies? What were they doing? Why were they so profitable? What was that? So I went and interviewed the CEOs, and they had seemingly no common characteristics. They were, you know, some had large sales abroad, others were very domestic, some were large, some were small, some were high tech, some were, it wasn't clear. And then I realized that they all shared what then I called the 7P.
Interesting.
And it wasn't in the data. It was in the CEO and what the company was doing and how the company was set up to operate. And they had these shared characteristics. So I had to make it a little bit so that the P becomes 7P. But basically they stand for profit because that's, I had selected them for profit, right? So the first thing is, and they weren't profitable by accident. The thing was, they were very profitable because they wanted to be profitable. There was one company that said, if the operating margin is not 30%, we won't do it. Okay. And the second P is plan.
Plan.
So they had a strategy. They were very maimuki. Okay, so how are we gonna become profitable, stay profitable, right? So if you talk to the managers, not only of Phanuc and Keyence, but that's Machiron.
Yes.
But some of these other smaller places, they were very clear how they would benefit from the rise of China by feeding into the global value chain at a very high point of input. So they had this, what I now call the Maino Umi strategy, all laid out, right? So we're going to be quick and nimble, and we're going to feed into the global value chains at the point where the profits are
and keep
highest.
Up with the growth of Chinese economy.
And then we can sell into this,
yes.
Right? And so we can benefit from the rise of this. The third P is paranoia, which Andy Grove from Intel once wrote a book that only the paranoid survive.
Yes, I remember.
Right?
Yes,
and what he means with that is not the actual disease, but although maybe I don't know what he meant, but what I mean is a sense of urgency, a sense of crisis.
Yes,
right. And so
being alert and
don't be complacent. Don't just sit back and say, we got this, right? Sort of no. You can never, because there might be a startup company, there might be a new, you know, somebody entering from another place, or a competitor might eat you up, right? So don't be complacent. Number four was parsimony, and that's actually a fancy English word for frugal or so, right? So
efficiency or
what I meant with this is efficient.
Okay.
So they were not wasting the nomura. They were not wasting time. They were not wasting resources. So this is, you know, a while back, but even then they were scheduling an interview was super easy. They were perfectly polite, very much to the point. Okay, it's 10 o'clock, come on to our office, it's here, right? And that was very different from some of the typical Japanese traditional companies where there was much more keigo, that was there were so many no's in the sentence, were hard to understand, you know, and then I had to, you know, confirm so many times. And it's very efficient. And I think that's now more common. That, for instance, that there are not three receptionists or something, right? So there was, but not just sort of saving money in a bad, in a stingy way, but just valuing or celebrating the value of time, right? And that people could go home, that people needed time to be creative, but they didn't need to spend time on endless meetings. Right? That sort of parsimony. Then PR stands for public relations, right? That's transparency.
Yes.
So could I, from their website, immediately understand what they were doing? And yes, so for those profitable companies that I looked at, everything was there. There was no secret in this strategy.
That's a good point, because Japan used to be not good at transparency, bad PRs.
Yeah.
So it's changing.
Well, there are still... you know, after this project now, I can actually go to a company's website and kind of say, that's all.
Right?
So yes, it's changing. Part of it is, of course, ongoing corporate governance reforms, right? So there's all this pressure, and part of it is, you know, more foreign shareholders.
Yes.
So there's more pressure to do this. But one of the companies I interviewed at the time, they just won a Tokyo Stock Exchange Award for exchange. Tokyo Stock Exchange Award for a most transparent financial statement.
That I actually agree, because after the reform of IR, investment relationships, I think Japanese companies are good at creating corporate reports, very good corporate reports compared to other countries
around
the world.
Yeah, and that's new.
It's new and...
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so that's sort of that's one of the 7P.
That's a good
they
point.
All had that.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. So their strategy was not the secret. The secret was how they executed on the strategy. And so then now we go to the final two.
Yeah.
One refers to leadership.
Okay.
So the people at the top. The CEOs I interviewed for this project was super impressive. And none of them was sort of this traditional Showa period Ojisan type. None of them.
Okay.
They were all very... forward-looking,
energetic,
risk-taking,
innovative.
And the last one, which is connected, is that the people who worked there were happy, even in 2010, and you know that was rare. But partially, it was made. But the leaders wanted; they realized that if people are unhappy, they're not productive. If people are, there's research that shows this, right? So unhappy people will not do good work. And so they laid out everything to make that happen. So I interviewed a company at Vivaco called Optex. And Optex makes motion sensors that opens doors, which in a place like Japan, especially Tokyo, is very complicated, because do you really want to get into the convenience store, or do you just walk past? Right? The door shouldn't open every time somebody walks past. So they had developed a technology that then became a world-leading technology in this sort of thing. And they had a new building at Biwako, and there were some kayaks right in front of the office building. I said, well, what's kayaking? And he said, well, our engineers have to be creative. So if they want to, for lunch, if they want to go out on the lake and paddle a little bit, you know, that's good for them.
Wow.
Right, so happy people.
Happy
And motivated people. Mm-hmm. So people that are proud. See, pride is often a bad word in Japanese.
Right. It seems like you're boasting or.
That's not what I mean here, right? It's more like that people are fulfilled and happy that they work for this company.
Self-esteem encouraging. Okay.
I work for this company and I'm happy to work here, right?
Okay.
And that was very hard and because we had so many companies that were stuck in these like Japan traditional sort of thing. There were lots of unhappy faces on the subway every morning, right? And
very
people
tired.
Oh, I have to go to work. I don't want to go to work. But the people that I interviewed in these companies, they wanted to go to work.
Great.
Because they had, you know, there was a purpose.
I like the 7Ps. I think the viewers should take a screenshot and follow your 7Ps. Yeah.
So this is in the new book. We haven't translated those. We left them as the 7Ps.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So I like your seven-piece story and also Japan inside. As a Japanese, it makes me feel good and maybe have pride. But at the same time, I was looking at the YouTube comments on our last videos, 1.3 million. Some were arguing that if we say too much good things about Japan, the CEOs yeah. will start not trying, or we're not kind of used to being praised by international voices or academia. So how do you think we should perceive these kind of narratives? Do we should we think have more confidence? Because we don't want to hear these good stories and not, you know, not try hard enough or say we're better, so we don't have to do anything. Yeah.
Until now, I thought of the state of the Japanese economy as some expression of the 20-80 principle, right? Where you know how you know 20% of what you do in a given day actually accounts for 80% of your productivity.
Yes. Uh-huh.
The rest is muda. Waste of time. Mm-hmm. Gonna walk to the coffee shop. Mm-hmm. You come back and take a nap. And this is also true, of course, in marketing and so forth. That, mm-hmm. that 20% of customers. Or, you know, the hotels, airlines, 20% of customers make up for 80%.
Yeah, they're the loyal customers, yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, and the Japanese economy until now was 20-80. But I think the what would be really cool for the country, for everybody's happiness, is if we could move that up to 40-60.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Right. So if more companies jump on the bandwagon and follow these front runners, and become have more of the 7P, right? And become more forward-looking, strategic, profit-oriented, paranoid in a good way, mm-hmm. right? Transparent with a good leadership, culture change, and happy people. Mm-hmm. And I think we're seeing this.
Mm.
Because so last year when we talked, it was a little bit that, oh, you're creating excuses why there can be no change mm. with a tight culture mm-hmm. and whatnot. But now I think the thing has already shifted, that if you don't change, you will soon look like a JTC, right? The Japan Traditional Company, which is actually a really cool term. It's a Japanese English, right? This doesn't exist in English, actually. This Showa poi, this Showa style. Yeah. And it's time for the Reiwa style. And I think the Reiwa style is going to be very different. And the more successes the 7P companies have, mm-hmm. the more other companies want to follow their lead,
mm-hmm.
right? And that's also part of changing on the strong foot.
Right.
Let's not talk about the losers. Mm-hmm. Let's stop talking about the companies that were not successful. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about case studies of successful players and then see what they did and then do the same thing.
You mentioned you're a basketball player. So in order to pivot, you have to put your strong foot on the ground, yeah. stiff, and then change. So it's important to concentrate on the strong foot.
Well, I mean, if you know, the professional basketball players, of course, are equally strong.
Yes.
But at my very low level, I would naturally pivot on my strong foot mm-hmm. because it needs to push me forward, mm-hmm. right? And in fact, as a defense player, you know what's a strong foot, so you can stop me from mm-hmm. doing that. But I think this is important, right? That we think about, okay, what is Japan good at? There are lots of things that Japan is not good at. Okay.
For example?
I think Japan is not good at some of the things that Silicon Valley are good, which in the business research we call shallow technology.
Mm.
And that sounds like a bad word, shallow. Yeah, where it says,
yeah, the surface. Yeah,
yeah. But that's not... That would be misleading. So don't think about that as a bad thing. So there's shallow technology and deep technology. And shallow tech is what made Silicon Valley initially part of Silicon Valley's charm. So Silicon Valley has actually both, right? So they have the semiconductors, which is deep tech. Mm-hmm. It takes a long time. Mm-hmm. Or biotech, right? Which takes a long time. That's a deep tech move where there's a disruptive technology, mm-hmm. takes up 10 years to come to fruition, mm-hmm. right? So deep technology is slow and meticulous and so on. Shallow tech is an app
seconds.
And like Airbnb.
Airbnb, yeah.
There was no technology there. Mm-hmm. It's brilliant. Mm-hmm. So that's why...
Just the app and like million users in one day. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then you can actually, within 2 years, a venture capitalist can recoup their investments, right? So it's a launch it, do a minimum viable product, try it out, make it better, exit with a, you know, as a unicorn in 2 years or something. Mm-hmm. That is, and by the way, some of these shallow tech companies can then soon become seriously deep tech.
Yes.
So if you look at places like Uber, mm-hmm. right, that started as a very clever mm-hmm. ride-sharing mm-hmm. app. I mean, the concept is brilliant, mm-hmm. but the technology initially wasn't. But now it is, right? Because they have all these mapping data
right.
and uh-huh. behavioral data mm-hmm. and customer data.
It's how people transport and everything. Yes.
Right. So mm-hmm. they are now a deep tech company, mm-hmm. and that transition is actually quite off. But if you think of something like TikTok, well, initially it's not deep tech.
Yeah, it's,
right?
It's a shallow tech app, thing. Yeah.
It's amazingly, you know, successful. And that's something. So you asked, what's Japan not good at? I think shallow tech is something that Japan is not necessarily that good at. Games, yes, but that's not shallow. That's actually pretty deep, mm-hmm. Right? And so there are some exceptions, of course, always, right? So I'm not making these black and white.
Yes, things,
but you asked directionally, mm-hmm. and so directionally, I think this idea of launching a half-cooked app as a minimum viable product. Seeing what the customer says, get a lot of criticism, right? And then make it better and exit in 2 years. That's just not something.
You're right. I think Japan too much follows on that narrative. We thought that ourselves that we need to be like them. But I think hearing your story, I think that may be a mistake or misjudgment for us.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah. So all the power to the shallow tech
yeah,
Japanese
yes,
startup
yeah, yes,
guys,
yes,
right?
Yeah, they're good, but yes.
They're great.
But,
and,
yes.
But the Japanese customer does not really have a lot of tolerance for
no.
minimum viable product,
no.
right? If it's not 100%, don't launch it.
No.
Right? Now we're going back to this tight culture, monozukuri,
yes. uh-huh. Uh-huh.
meticulous mm-hmm. following and so forth. So a lot of Japanese startups that I see now that I think are really, really good are actually in the deep tech category.
That is a good point, yes. I agree. Mm-hmm.
All that means is it takes longer. You can't be an aerospace startup and be a unicorn in 2 years. That is not going to happen.
That's right.
That doesn't happen in Silicon Valley either, by the way. Right? I mean, the deep tech companies in Silicon Valley have a runway of 10 years.
That's true. They're not on media, but they're like on the ground beneath the surface
yeah.
and trying hard for 10 or 20 years. That's yeah. right. Yeah.
And so I think this is actually a very interesting moment right now with the sushi tech in Tokyo and Prime Minister, mm-hmm. New capitalism.
Yes, new capitalism.
Push for, mm-hmm. you know, I hope that Japan can be patient because I think Prime Minister Kishida wants to see results in 5 years. They're going to put all this money out mm-hmm. there and say,
5 years.
5 years.
Unicorns.
I need unicorns galore, right? And that's just not going to happen. And normally Japan is very patient. And I think Japan needs to be patient here.
I think that's what we are good at, taking time.
Yeah.
But not being slow, but taking time and being stiff. Yeah. Let's talk about culture. Because in our last episode, this was a very popular graph.
Yes.
So Japan, obviously, we're kind of tight culture, but interesting that there's some overlaps between Japan and United States also.
Yeah, that's the chance, mm-hmm. right? That's the opportunity. Mm-hmm. Because what this means, when we talk about how countries are different, we're not saying black and white, you know, all Japanese are this and all
tight,
Americans
are this.
There is a normal distribution for everything,
mm-hmm.
right? Everything has a normal distribution. Mm-hmm. And so it is for Japanese people. There are some people that are by character, by upbringing, by family traditions, by whatever. A school, friends, you know, however they're shaped, more loose than others,
mm-hmm.
right? And then that's true in Japan and in America and in Germany and so forth. So what we then get is we get these normal distributions of people. And so all that graph is supposed to show is that the most loose Japanese person, it's much more loose than the tightest
Americans,
right?
Yeah.
And there are lots of tight Americans.
Yes. Because there's a lot
Absolutely.
Of Americans that like behave like Japanese in a way, very, very
or
majime,
even tighter.
tighter, yes,
right, and uh-huh. and then that's and they're very organized,
yes, and organized, and, yeah, majime, yes,
and there are lots of people in Japan that are, you know, not really that I mean,
I know, very innovative, very moving around. Yes.
Yeah. Those are the reformers.
Right.
Those are the creative people. Those are the artists.
Yes.
Those are the fashion designers. Those are, you know, and they are also the corporate explorers, mm-hmm. right? So they are in large companies mm-hmm. where they very patiently but steadily bring about change. Mm-hmm. And by the way, that's another thing that I think is changing now, that there are more reformers.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. There are the front runners mm-hmm. Are leading the way, and there are more and more people in Japan that are saying, yeah, it's time to change. Mm-hmm. And they bring about change. And so it's important to notice that it's not just that Japan is tight and therefore nothing will happen and America is.
I see that, so, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this is also true for the startups, right? Mm. So there are shallow tech startups in Japan, of course.
True.
Right? And there are deep tech startups in the United States, of course.
True. Mm-hmm.
Certainly in biotech because of regulation in
yes.
Japan. And in the United States it's much looser, mm-hmm. right? So you can do it better there.
Mm-hmm.
But also in flying rockets into space and that mm-hmm. sort of thing, America is good at that. So and Silicon Valley started
yes.
with going to the moon.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to be careful that we don't make these swift sort of categorizations. But at the mean, at the normal, for the normal person, for the normal sort of distribution high point, I think there are clear differences, and these will also express in the innovation ecosystem.
Hmm. Maybe in the 2010s, it was the age of social media apps, but the world itself is changing. So I think it's a good chance for Japan to realize our strengths and keep that strength. Having that said, let's talk about Sushi Tech. How this event will change Japan in a good direction.
So my interpretation
yes.
of what the
yes.
goal is with
yes.
this uh-huh. is to bring together mm-hmm. Ideas
yes.
and mm-hmm. users of those ideas.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And the users of those ideas could be either money mm-hmm. or companies that want the idea,
mm-hmm.
right? And so create a market for
mm-hmm.
ideas.
Mm-hmm.
And the market, we know that from business school, right?
Yes.
Network effects, mm-hmm. the more the merrier.
Yes.
So the more you can bring together in one place,
mm-hmm.
the more opportunity you create mm-hmm. for new ideas,
mm-hmm.
right? Also the startups can create new ideas,
yes.
right? Because they're the two startup guys mm-hmm. come together, they might form a third startup, right?
Mm-hmm.
But also, I think this is about this longstanding thing of connecting startup companies with larger companies and with venture capitalists.
Mm-hmm.
And Tokyo has a lot of places where there are incubators.
Agree. Mm-hmm.
There are accelerators. There's a lot,
mm-hmm.
right? And Japan, not just Tokyo.
Mm-hmm.
Japan has a lot
mm-hmm.
of this. So they're small and they're
mm-hmm. they're not
many
connected
different places,
mm-hmm.
right? And so to bring everybody into one place
mm-hmm.
and say, hey, meet, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so 40,000 visitors. That's a lot of visitors.
Yes.
And the exhibitions are, of course, the startups talking about, you know, and the business negotiations, I assume, are about mm-hmm. either the venture capitalists thinking about funding or large companies thinking about
yes.
buying. And so I think the Sushi Tech
mm-hmm.
Tokyo idea is great for that
mm.
because the more we can bring ideas together and the more people come, you know, the more liquid that market
mm-hmm.
and the more opportunity is created.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that sense, I congratulate Governor Koike on her initiative there.
That's true.
Yeah.
Also, Sushi Tech has a lot of distinguished guests, like from Bloomberg. So very international guests from around the world. So today we talked about 7P's Japan Insight. Do you think that we ourselves as a Japanese business community need to address that narrative to the world instead of just copying, or we have to tell our own story? Do you agree with that? Or do you think we need more people to tell the world, like you said today?
Yeah, you know, mm-hmm. that story about Lost Japan,
yes.
And you know, the other thing I didn't mention
mm-hmm.
earlier, but it might be interesting, is that this whole zombie story,
mm-hmm.
there's now a new book out that has shown that it was overstated and the data actually don't bear
out. Really? I didn't know that.
Yes. So the data were true for that bad period of the banking crisis from 98 to
yes.
2005.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, there were
yes.
these
Fudio
companies.
Saiken. Yes, yes, yes.
Definitely true. There
mm-hmm.
were companies that were artificially kept alive
yes, that's
by their
true.
Banks.
Mm-hmm.
But after that, these new researchers, Japanese economists, have found that the stagnation was not because of the zombies and this inefficiency, but rather that the very good companies were nervous about investing money. Right, because of the global financial crisis, and all kinds of stuff happening. So even the zombie story is now being, you know, challenged. Okay. Right? And so I think it really is time to not have American economists tell the Japanese story, but have Japan tell its own story.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Right? And the challenge with that is that we've heard this stagnation story for so long. I mean, even the comments on our previous interview were all like, she can't be right. Yeah, she doesn't know what she's talking about.
She's lying.
It's nice that people comment on the show, and that's great. But let's reframe that story about, yes, we went through a hard time, but all through these hard years, there has been a transformation going on, and the results are beginning to show now.
Mm.
And you know, and Japan has people like Namba-san, who is I'm a huge fan, and you know, it's just not this image that Japan cannot innovate, that Japanese women are not strong, that, you know, and she single-handedly has
changed the whole narrative. Yeah.
Yeah. And she's not alone, happily. There are lots of other people like that.
And Kay Dunnan invited her as a vice chair. So I think.
Well, there.
Kay Dunnan is also changing.
Even the OB club is changing. Mm-hmm. So I think it really is happening.
Mm.
And so it's a choice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what story would you rather tell? And one of the challenges, of course, now we have, you know, ChatGPT and DeepL and Google Translate. So if Japan perpetuates this negative story, it's immediately available in English.
Mm-hmm.
So then the question is, maybe we should tell a different story altogether.
Yes, and I think we need to kind of make use of these kind of events to tell the story to the world. Not just inviting guests from outside, but also expressing our stories to the world. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But we talked about one of the pieces, pride.
Yes.
And one of the very likable
mm-hmm.
features of Japan, as Japanese people are very modest,
mm-hmm.
and that's what's not to like.
Yeah, it's a good
nice.
Thing. Yes, it's nice. Yes.
And they're very humble, mm-hmm. and they always say, "Well, I'm not that good at this," and something. And we want to keep. I mean, we don't want to tell all the Japanese to go around the world and say, "Oh, I'm wonderful."
We're wonderful. With Japan's best.
It's not happening.
No. Yeah.
But a little bit more of a self-confidence.
True.
A quiet self-confidence is fine.
Quiet self-confidence. That's a good term.
Mm-hmm. Right. It doesn't mm-hmm. have to be boastful. It doesn't mm-hmm. have. You know, we don't have to become like these urusai people. But the Germans, by the way, are similar to Japanese in that regard, right? And so Germans grow up. You know, don't boast. You know, don't tell everybody how good you are. They'll see and they'll find out, right? And Americans are not like that on average.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's time though to find maybe a new way of telling a quietly confidential story. I mean, a story filled with confidence about why Japan still matters.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that would be great. If you could help that would be wonderful.
Okay. Okay, Rikki Shades, thank you for your time today. I really enjoyed the interview.
It was wonderful. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.